Briefly, I want to talk from the subject, Jesus is amazing. Jesus is amazing. Amen. Thank you, Urshas. Bless you all. Would you all give our junior Urshas a hand? Amen. Jesus is amazing. What I just read here in the second chapter of the Gospel of St. Mark is that Jesus has come back to a city called Capernaum. Scripture tells us that when he had arrived back in Capernaum, that he went into a house and word soon got out that Jesus was back in town. We believe that Jesus spent a lot of time in Capernaum. He certainly worked many miracles there in Capernaum, that people had begun to know who he was as far as being a miracle worker. And so word got out that Jesus is back in town. And when word rapidly spread, people began to gather where he was. It is believed by most of us that the house that he was in belonged to Simon Peter. Peter and Andrew had opened the doors of their house and had welcomed Jesus in. So now the people have gathered there at that house, and when they had gathered there, there was no room to get in through the door. And Jesus, seeing this multitude of people there, he began to preach to them. And while he was preaching, the text says that there came four men carrying a paralyzed man on a pallet or on a stretcher. And scripture said their goal was to get the man to Jesus. But the people wouldn't move. They said, look, can we get through? We're trying to get this man to Jesus. But nobody moved. It seemed like somebody would have had sense enough to move out the way and let them get the man to Jesus. I mean, if you're not going to help bring them, at least get out the way of the folk that will bring them. But nobody would move. So the record says that they came up with another plan. Most houses had flat top roofs and which were had stairs that were made on the side of the house. So they decided, if we can't get to him one way, we'll go another way. And they went up on top of the house and they tore open the roof and they lowered the man down in the presence of Jesus. Jesus looked up and he said to the man who was sick, son, your sins are forgiven you. When they lowered him down, Jesus noticed what some of the scribes were thinking who were there. And Jesus said, why are you thinking in your hearts these things? What they were thinking was that who this man think he is, that he can forgive sins. Only God can do that. And Jesus said, I know what you're thinking. Say, but let me ask you a question. Is it easier to say, son, your sins are forgiven? Or to say, rise, take up your bed and walk? And Jesus said, but that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins. He looked at the man who was paralyzed and said, I say to you, get up and walk. And immediately, the man got up and was able to walk. And the people were amazed, and they gave God glory. There was shouting that happened right there because of what Jesus had done. And brothers and sisters, they saw then that this Jesus man is amazing. And my brothers and sisters, as I look at this text teaches me a lot about Jesus being amazing. Notice when they brought this man, they did their part. They got him to Jesus. And after they got him to Jesus, Jesus did the rest. And I believe, first of all, we must see the need to do our part. If you want to see how amazing Jesus really is, do your part. Preacher, what is my part? As a believer, our part is to get people to Jesus. look at it. The text teaches us that these four men brought this paralyzed man to Jesus. And I believe if you're going to get people to Jesus, you got to first learn how to be a friend. As I looked at this text, this man had at least five friends. He had the four that brought him, but he had the one that healed him. These four men saw the need to bring this man to Jesus. And my brothers and sisters, there are folk just waiting for somebody to help them to get to Jesus. You know, sometimes we try to dismiss it by saying, well, they know where the church is. Listen, even if they come to the church, that's not the same. It's one thing to get them to church, but it's another to get them to Jesus. Whole lot of folk come to church who never make it to Jesus. Are y'all praying with me? It takes some effort to get folk to Jesus. These men were friends to the man that they brought to Jesus. They saw the need to get him to Jesus. So the text teaches us, first of all, you got to be a friend and care enough about folk to get them to Jesus. But then notice, each man had to hold up his corner. They cooperated with each other, and they each held up their corner. If they had not each held up their corner, they could have dropped the man. Are y'all praying with me? They, in order for them to successfully get him to Jesus, each man had to hold up his corner. I come to tell you, brothers and sisters, you got to hold up your corner. As a member of the church, you got a corner. And God is expecting you to hold up your corner. If your corner is a choir member, you ought to hold up your corner. If your corner is to be a usher, hold up your corner. Whatever your corner is, hold up your corner. Support, be a good member, be a faithful member. Talk good about your church. Tell folks, look, baby, if you don't go to church, come to our church. Hold up your corner. Each man held up his corner. Next thing I see, they were determined to get him there because they didn't let the crowd stand in the way. And listen, when it comes to getting to Jesus, you can't let the crowd stop you. You can't be discouraged by the crowd because there are some folk, they're not going to move. Some folk, when they sang that song, "I shall not be moved," they mean it. They're not moving for nobody. Some people, when they get positioned in the church, they don't want to move. They act like that it belongs to them. But let me remind us here, all of us are just here for just a little while. And one day, we're going to pass away. And like it or not, somebody's going to take our place. They wouldn't move out the way, but they said, listen, we're going to get him to him another way. So they went up on top of the house, and they tore open the hole in the roof, and they let that man down to Jesus. Sometimes you gotta break through some stuff in order to get to Jesus. Sometimes you got to break through barriers in order to get to Jesus. Sometimes you can break through the barrier of an unforgiving spirit, the barrier of a covetous spirit, the barrier of a rebellious spirit. Sometimes you got to break through some barriers to get to Jesus. And they got him there. They did it. They did their part. And they got this man to Jesus. I'm almost through. But what I love about this text, once they got to Jesus, Jesus took over. Are y'all listening to me? Anybody here know that once you do your part, and when you've done all you can do, the Lord can do the rest. The got into them, and Jesus took over. And right here in this chapter, I see just how amazing he is. Look at it right quick. First of all, I see that he's amazing in his presence. Because the text said that when he came back to Capernaum, it was noise that he was in the house. Now listen, you got to see more than what's on the surface. Whoever house it was, I'm glad they had Jesus in there. You know, every house needs Jesus in it. Jesus was in the house. And what I want to point out here, one of the amazing things about him being there is because he made himself accessible. The man who was paralyzed needed him. And Jesus made himself available. Amen. Isn't it good to know that whenever you need him, he makes himself available? He's never too busy to have time for you. Whenever you need him, he is always available. Are you listening to me? Sometimes you need to see a doctor, you gotta wait. You gotta get an appointment. Sometimes you may not get to see him the day you want to get to see him. But with Jesus, he's always available. Am I right about it? Yes, he makes himself available. He's accessible. You can get to him. Amen. You know, some folk even in our churches have become too important. Well, can't nobody get to them. When I say that, I'm talking about some preachers who have become so big and so popular. So holy, you know, where can't nobody get to him. You gotta make an appointment to shake their hand. Are you listening to me? They too important. But Jesus is always accessible. Are y'all listening to me? And oh, brothers and sisters, since Jesus makes himself available, we ought to always be available. Yes, this text, he's amazing in that he's always there just when you need him. Somebody here can testify with me, every time I needed him, he was there. He was always there for me. Even sometime when I wasn't looking for him, he was still there. He's amazing in his presence, but then secondly, he's amazing in his preaching. Because text said after folk got there, he preached to them. He preached the word to them. The best preaching ever was done by Jesus. I mean, no preacher can measure up to the preaching of Jesus. In his preaching, you receive instructions. He instructed us on how to do right and how to avoid wrong. He instructed us on how to treat people, how to treat your family, how to treat your friends, and even to love your enemies. His teaching, his preaching was full of instruction. But then his preaching also would give you insight. A lot of things that you couldn't understand, he would help you to understand. His preaching would reveal it and make it plain to you. Yes, my brothers and sisters, his preaching would give you insight. But then thirdly, his preaching would have an impact. Many lives were changed through his preaching. And you know, preaching still changes lives. Bible says it has pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. Preaching still works. Am I right about it? Ezekiel had a vision of a valley of dry bones, and the Lord asked him a question, said, Ezekiel, can these bones live? Ezekiel said, Lord, you know. And in the 37th chapter of the book of Ezekiel, the Lord said, Ezekiel, I want you to preach to them. Tell those bones what thus said the Lord. Ezekiel said, I started preaching. And when I started preaching what the Lord said, there was a noise in the valley. God shook that valley and those bones started shaking. Toe bone found foot bone. Foot bone got connected to ankle bone. Ankle bone found leg bone. Leg bone hooked up to knee bone. Knee bone got a hold of thigh bone. Thigh bone found hip bone. Hip bone found back bone. Back bone was connected to neck bone. Neck bone and back bone had shoulder bones that had arm bones that had wrist bone, hand bone, finger bone. Bones came together. And it happened through the preaching. Preaching still brings bones together. Have I got a witness here? And we got all kind of bones in this valley. We got some lying bones, gambling bones, some drug using bones, prostituting bones, drunk bones, pimping bones, all kind of bones, but the preaching will bring a change. His preaching. But the third thing I see is he's amazing in his perception. In his perception. The verse said Jesus perceived that there are at least three things I want to point out that he saw. First of all, he saw the faith of the ones who came. The verse said, when Jesus saw their faith, that's what gets God's attention. You can't impress God with a hairdo. I don't care what color your hair is, your weave, whatever. You can't impress God. Are y'all listening to me? We can't impress God with fancy garments. You think you're scoring with God with your $600, $700 shoe? Don't get God's attention. Are y'all listening to me? Your name brand suits don't get God's attention. All right, have it. But that don't get God's attention. If you want to get God's attention, have faith. The Bible said without faith, it's impossible to please God. But he that cometh to God must first of all believe that he exists and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek. You got to have faith. You got to believe that in spite of the circumstances, Jesus can make the difference. In spite of how it looks, God can give us a breakthrough. In spite of what the doctor said, God can give me a miracle in my life. He saw their faith, and if he sees their faith, he sees our faith. He knows when you have faith. God is looking for some faith. Not only did he see their faith, I don't know, was he able to perceive the faith of those, but he also saw the heart of the paralyzed man. It's revealed right here. Jesus says, son, your sins are forgiven. So it's obvious that this man had forgiveness on his mind. That he wanted the forgiveness of the Lord. And this God knows the desires of your heart. Am I right about it? He knows what you think. He knows when you really need him. He knows when you're seeking him from the depths of your heart. That's why whatever you do for God, you ought to do it from your heart. Are you listening to me? I love good singing. Some folk can just sing. I mean, I didn't say sing, they can just sing. They can sing. But it makes a difference if your heart is in. You can tell when some folk just singing from the throat. over against singing from their heart. You know what I discovered? I've seen folk who got a beautiful voice, but their singing don't move you. But yet here comes somebody that can't sing as good. But when their heart is in it, it'll bring tears to your eyes. Your heart got to be in it. He saw the heart of this man. But then he saw also, he perceived the thoughts of the scribes who were there. He knew what they were thinking. They were thinking, say, who can forgive sins but God? What they didn't know was God was in the house. Because Jesus is God. Are y'all listening to me? Oh, my brothers and sisters, the Lord knows what you're thinking. He's aware of what's on your mind. And so he's amazing in his perception. But then finally, I need to tell you, he's amazing in his power. Look at it. He got power to forgive. Am I right about it? That's the first action that Jesus took. He first forgave the man. And listen, everybody needs forgiveness. Why you say everybody need forgiveness, preacher? Because everybody have a sin problem. And this is the greatest blessing we can ever receive from God, is forgiveness of our sins. What good is it to drive an expensive car if your sins have not been forgiven? What good is to live in a mansion if your sins have not yet been forgiven? What good is it to have a lot of money in the bank if your sins have not been forgiven? Oh, my brothers and my sisters, Jesus said, what is a man profiting if he should gain the whole world and lose his soul? It means everything to have God's forgiveness in your life. And so Jesus first forgave this man for his sin. And oh, but not only did the Lord have power to forgive him, but the Lord had power to heal him. The record said, Jesus said, is it easier to say your sins are forgiven? That's an invisible thing. But since you have trouble believing on the invisible, I'm about to give you something you can see to prove to you that I am able to forgive sin. He looked at the man and said, sir, rise up and walk. And the record says immediately the man was able to get up. And he walked in front of everybody. Jesus proved he got power to heal. Am I right about it? And I'm wondering here today, is there anybody else here that knows that the Lord is amazing? He's amazing because he's got power to heal a broken heart, power to heal a sin-sick body. He's got power to give you victory over anything. Have I got a witness? Well, somebody here, you might be experiencing some kind of paralysis. Yes, maybe your goals have been paralyzed. Maybe your hope is paralyzed. Maybe you are paralyzed to the point to where you can't even worship God. When it comes to serving God, you've been paralyzed. You used to be active, but somewhere along the way, you became paralyzed. Well, the good news is, if you look to Jesus, he got power to put you on your feet again. Have I got a witness? Well, my brothers and sisters, I'm through now, but Jesus truly is so amazing. Have I got a witness here? The record says what he did on that day, he did it in the house. Have you noticed many times when the Lord got ready to bless somebody, many times it happened in a house? Yes, when the wise men came from the east to see the newborn king, the Bible says when they worshiped him, it happened in a house. Have I got a witness? When Mary took her hair and wiped the Lord's feet, it happened in a house. Am I right about it? When Jairus' daughter was raised from the dead, it happened in a house. Yes, when Peter's mother-in-law was healed of her fever, it happened in his house. When Thomas believed that Jesus had risen from the dead, he believed in a house. Yes, when those two men had been walking with him on the Emmaus Road and didn't know who he was, it was when they got to the house that the eyes were opened and they realized they had been walking with Jesus. It happened in a house. Thank God, all right. Is anybody here got a testimony what God did for you in a house? Thank God, all right. When he woke us up this morning, it happened in the house. When he started us on our way, it happened in a house. When he heard our prayers, it happened in a house. Anybody here got an in-house testimony? Thank God, all right. Well, Jesus proves that he is amazing. Thank God, all right. If that woman who had an issue of blood could stop by, she would tell you, he is so amazing. I had an issue of blood for 12 years, and I touched the hem of his garment, and he healed me of my disease. And he did it because he's amazing. Thank God, all right. Yes, if Lazarus was here, he would tell you, I was dead and buried for 4 days, but the Lord brought me back to life because he's amazing. Thank God, all right. If that couple who got married in Cana of Galilee could stop by, they would tell you, we had run out of wine, but Jesus turned water into the best wine because he is so amazing. Ain't God, all right. Anybody here got your own testimony about how amazing he is? If he picked you up, you can testify he is amazing. If he started you on your way, you can testify he's amazing. If he healed your body, you can tell somebody he is amazing. Ain't God, all right. If he saved you from your sins, you can be a witness. He is amazing. Ain't God, all right? He's so amazing that out on Calvary's Hill, when they nailed him to a cross, one thief looked at him and said, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said, today you're gonna be with me in paradise. He's so amazing. He's so amazing that he died on that cross. I heard him say, no man takes my life, but I lay it down. And when I lay it down, I'm able to take it up again. He died, but on the third day, he rose again because he is amazing. Anybody here know he is amazing? be the best thing that ever happened to me. Anybody here know he'll give you joy in your sorrow? He's our hope for tomorrow. He's everything, everything we need. Ain't he all right? Yeah. Ain't he all right? Yeah. Oh, yeah. God bless you.